As a software developer, one of the worst things that can happen to me is that I work on something for a while and then it doesn't ship. This is one of the reasons that I didn't pursue games like I originally thought I was going to. After working in the Flight Simulator 2002 team and hearing some of the horror stories that people had to tell about working on things and companies folding or the studio that they're in not finding a way to ship their code, that was enough to tell me, nope, that's something I absolutely shouldn't do. Unfortunately, this is something that can happen anywhere, not just in games. So today I'm going to tell you a horror story about how I worked on some technology for half a year that didn't wind up shipping. I'll also give you some tips on how to avoid being in that situation yourself. Hi, I'm John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I spent 30 years working in big tech and FAANG companies like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, and Oracle, delivering software in a variety of places. I was both a software engineer and a principal engineer for about the last 15 years. During those years, I've had many sweet, sweet victories, but I've also had my share of defeats, and today I'm going to tell you about one of those defeats when I was working in peer networking technologies at Microsoft. From 2000 to 2008, I was working primarily on peer-to-peer technologies at Microsoft. These included the Peer-to-Peer Toolkit, Universal Plug-and-Play, and Avalanche File Swarming Protocol. While I was working on peer-to-peer technologies for Windows, we got visits from Microsoft Research in Cambridge. There was a peer-to-peer research team there that had a lot of really interesting technology, and they had a lot of solid research results saying this would be a good thing to try. However, at the time they came to visit us, we'd already gone through our initial scoping, vision, come up with the designs, prototype them, and we were well on our way to implementing them. It was just the wrong time for us to consider new technology. So we didn't wind up adopting any of their technology at that time. After that first version of peer-to-peer technology shipped in Windows, I started looking for something new to do. One of the jobs that cropped up was actually working as a software development manager at Microsoft Research Cambridge, the same lab that had that peer-to-peer technology, among many other different things. So I applied for the job, I managed to get it, and I moved out there. Now, as a software engineering manager there, I had a bunch of RSDEs reporting to me, research software engineers, that already were in the middle of jobs, they knew exactly what they were doing, they really didn't need any oversight from me. That meant the only person with nothing to do was me as the development manager. I decided to see if I could take some of that peer-to-peer technology that they'd developed there and integrate that into Windows. Normally, when research approaches a product team and tries to get their technology into that product, there's a couple protests that always come up. One is that the technology just isn't as proven as the researchers think it is because of all the things that can go wrong that are related to implementation details. Another is that the team already has a big chunk of work that they want to get done for the next couple years, and if they adopt that technology from the research team, they're going to have to staff it up and do that development themselves and not do some of the other things that they were excited about doing. When you combine these together, it makes it a pretty hard sell. Now, since I had already worked in the peer-to-peer team and delivered code in that code base, if I volunteered to do the port of the what was called pastry peer-to-peer technology from research into the code base, that should eliminate both of those objections. First, they wouldn't have to provide any resources for it. And second, I'd already delivered code in that code base. I knew exactly what it took to do it. I knew how to test it, and I knew how to verify that the code was really going to work. The technology that I proposed transferring was something called Practical Internet Coordinates, which had been recently researched as part of the pastry research at MSR Cambridge and seemed like a good candidate to add value to the peer-to-peer that was already in Windows. It was a way of estimating what your latency was going to be talking to an arbitrary endpoint without having to contact that endpoint. The idea was that each of the people participating in a cloud had a set of Cartesian coordinates that described relative location for them. When you join the cloud, you would connect up and test your connectivity to a couple of the well-known coordinate points. Based on that, you could calculate your own coordinates, and because of something called the triangle inequality, usually holding on the internet, you would be able to estimate just how long the round trip time would be to an arbitrary endpoint. What this meant in practical terms was, for a protocol that you wind up connecting to lots of people and disconnecting, you could take a big list of people and prioritize them based on how close they were to you, which in turn would increase the chances of you being able to connect to them and also decrease the amount of time that it took to have a transaction with them. So it was definitely something that would be helpful for the protocols. Since I'd just been working in the peer-to-peer team, I picked up the templates for the various documents that were required to propose a feature. filled them out, got them reviewed by the team, got them approved, and everybody was pretty happy to have me working on this and basically to get a feature that would help peer-to-peer without the peer-to-peer team having to do any work whatsoever. Since I was 5,000 miles away from Redmond in Cambridge, England, they had me work with one of the PMs that I used to work with, program managers. He was my single point of contact, and I would talk to him and coordinate the things that I was doing with him, including, you know, getting final sign-off on things and understanding timelines and the rest of it. My initial estimate for getting the work done was November or December of 2004. So I was working along with this. It looked like I might slip a little bit. So I let the program manager know, hey, it looks like this might go into the early part of January of next year. Is that okay? And the answer I got back was, ugh. Well, you know, actually, things are kind of tight right now. So it's really important to get this feature done and checked in by the end of December. I really wanted this first tech transfer to work, and I thought it was a good value add for my old team, and it would be an easy victory in the research team that I was in now. So I went ahead and started working 7 days a week. I worked all the way through December, every day, and did finally get the code done and got it ready for check-in by, I think, December 29th or so. Then I started pinging the program manager saying, hey, I'm ready for check-in. When can I check in? When can I check in? One quick side note for those of you who haven't had to work on making a big check-in on a team that's also doing its own big check-ins, there's something called a merge race. When you add code to a large code base, anybody else who's doing significant changes in that code base has to synchronize the changes you've made to their code, and that's something that can take anywhere from days to weeks. While I was working on this, I was in a merge race with another developer in the team who had been working for several weeks himself. So we were waiting to see if he got it checked in before me, then I would have to spend a couple weeks, maybe a month even, incorporating his changes, re-architecting whatever I needed to re-architect in my code, and verifying that everything still works. So I was highly incented to get this in by the end of December. Back to our story. So I kept asking, when can I check in? When can I check in? But I was getting radio silence. Now this worried me, so I switched from sending mails to starting to call until I finally got a hold of the PM and I said, hey, you know, when can I check in this code? It's ready. And he's like, about that. Actually, it looks like it's gonna be on hold for a while. We're not sure what's happening, but I'll let you know. Being on hold is another way of saying, well, I don't think it's going to make it in, but you know, there's a chance, so we'll see what happens. So I was pretty devastated by this. As it turns out, I wasn't the only person in this position. There was something called the Longhorn reset that was just being considered at this time. If you worked at Microsoft in that period, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. But from the outside, what it means is that on the way to developing Windows Vista, the company had decided they needed to take a closer look at some of the big assumptions and big bets they were making in that release. And the way that they did this was they stopped development of Vista, and as I recall, they actually made a brand new branch that they were going to base Vista off of, and anything that had been worked on so far was going to be examined piece by piece, and a decision made about whether it could be shipped or not. If it could be shipped, then it would be moved into this new branch that was going to be the actual shipping branch for Vista. What this means is my work was definitely out, and in fact, the work that the team had been doing for the last year or two was also more or less out. They got to put about half of the work that they had already finished into what shipped in Vista, and even that they had to really crunch to get it done. I felt bad that I didn't get a chance to ship my code, right? Six months or so of development and specking and all the rest, doing everything right. But they had a lot more work they hadn't gotten to ship, and it wasn't just networking, it was all of Windows in this boat. I guess that made me feel a little better, but not a whole lot, because ultimately I'd still just spent 6 months trying to get an easy win and failed abysmally at it. I promised I'd give some suggestions on how to avoid having this happen to you. So what could I have done differently in this case that would have prevented the code from not shipping? You know, this is a really special case. So in this particular case, I would say, well, you know, probably nothing. However, I've been in similar situations, not quite as dire, with other projects, and there's things that definitely make a difference in terms of improving your chances of shipping. First, make sure that you're integrated into the team as closely as possible. I was geographically 5,000 miles away, but I could have been getting up a little earlier every day and attending their stand-ups and their weekly status meetings and things like this. This is an important way of showing that you have skin in the game and that you can be relied on. It's also a way for you to get the same signals that everybody else on the team is getting rather than getting them filtered through your point of contact. It's a fair amount of extra effort, but it really does improve your chances of succeeding. Second, make sure you know who the stakeholders are for the project and keep them involved and keep them up to date. So I mostly worked with the PM because I already knew all the other people involved, but the reality is, even though I knew the people involved, I should have been talking regularly to the product unit manager who owned all of peer-to-peer and to the development manager who owned all of the software development for that peer-to-peer group. Even if I didn't necessarily have a formal meeting with them, I should have been pinging them once a week or so and saying, hey, here's how things are coming along, you know, how are things going for you guys? Do you have any questions for me? Any advice I can give as a ex-member of the team, an interested party? That sort of informal link-up can really help improve the confidence people have in your ability to ship. The third thing you should do is very difficult to do if you're remote, but it's worth actually making trips to do, and that is try to make sure that you get some of the water cooler or the corridor chatter. In other words, that you are around when people are talking informally between meetings, when they're not working, at lunch, whatever, just so you get more of a flavor of concerns people might have. This is something that I saw in the TouchMouse project I was in, where I spent a lot of time in Seattle for that. And as I wandered around, I would hear murmurs from people like, oh, you know, so-and-so is a little worried that the work you guys are doing isn't gonna pan out, and things like this. By hearing that through the grapevine, I was able to go and reassure people who had doubts and then sort of proactively give a larger presentation to the leadership of the project to say, hey, here's where we're at, here's why it looks this way right now, here's where we're going to be, and it's a very safe path to get there. That did a lot to allay concerns and to get people to let us keep working on this project. Finally, you want to be transparent and optimistic. You always want to tell the truth about things. It's important to contextualize it, just like I said, oh yes, things are bad right now, but that's expected because we haven't been emphasizing this particular part. Instead, we've been doing these things. Our plan is to do this to fix the problem you're seeing. It's going to be fixed in this many weeks, and I can change that around and prioritize it for you if you want. But everything's going to be okay. So transparent, let them know why things are the way they are, and optimistic. Pretty much everything works out most of the time. Even when it feels like it won't, I can't count the number of times I've been in a project and convinced it's absolutely going to fail, and then everything works out okay. So just be optimistic up front and always be positive, and you'd be surprised what a difference that makes in the chances of success for a project. So that's pretty much it. Practical internet coordinates never did make its way into Windows, but it was a great idea, and I learned a lot doing it. I got to know people better. Overall, it was time well spent. It would have been nice if it shipped, but even though it didn't, I learned how to do my job better, which is always valuable. Have you ever worked on a project that wound up getting thrown away? I'd love to hear your stories down below and any ideas you have about how you can keep things from getting thrown away. Or if you don't agree with some of my advice, I'd love to hear that too. So please leave a comment. Thanks for listening to my story and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks, and keep on pushing forward.